for an uncertain life. We did not believe that was a practical expenditure of money for a very short-term return on investment. We then explored the purchase or the possibility of purchasing a brand new aerial and mounting it on the current chassis. But in 1991, new NFPA regulations, which are the standards adopted by the National Fire Protection Association, went into effect, and they necessitate a heavier aerial construction than can be supported by our current chassis. So with that, we cannot buy a new aerial that the chassis will support. So having effectively ruled out the possibility of anything being done with our current chassis as far as being used as an aerial ladder, we explored the options of looking at used aerials. As both the chief and the town manager said, Gilly Jordan spent a lot of time on the phone. I think he knows every aerial manufacturer east of the Mississippi and or every repair facility. We've spent a lot of time talking to people, and we've also been in contact with the people that sell used fire apparatus. The costs range from $100,000 to $250,000 to up to $300,000, depending on what you're buying, and in age from 15 to 25 years and even older. The problem with a used aerial is that our size of our station restricts what we can purchase with the length of the bays and the height of the doors. And also, we don't know how that truck was used prior to us purchasing it, what its maintenance history was, what the actual condition is, and how long that aerial will last. Also, any used ladder will not meet current NFPA standards, anything that was manufactured prior to 1991. And we also were concerned about anything that is on the market now, about its condition, because any town that has a truck that is obviously can be refurbished, rebuilt, will spend that money as it's cheaper than buying a new one, and if they can get the added service life out of it. So the amount of used aerials on the market has diminished in this time period. And also the cost concerned us. The return, if we bought a used aerial with its service life, the cost of that and a new one per year would range to the same price, within $1,000 or so per year, based on the expenditure for the truck to buy it to begin with. With all those in mind, we then, knowing that we could not repair our current truck, knowing that we could not mount a new aerial on the truck, and if we mounted a used aerial, it would be a very short-term solution, resulting in expenditure of money that we don't feel would be well spent because of the uncertainty of the life of the aerial. We then explored looking at buying a brand new, or specifying and buying a brand new aerial for the town. Several advantages, obviously, to buying a new aerial: that we know what it is, it's designed for what this community needs, it's not what some other community needed. We can design and spec a truck that will fit inside our current facility with minor modifications, which is an important factor, as that will delay for any number of years the need of the fire department to expand for additional bays. Any new aerial will meet and comply with NFPA standards, which results in a far safer truck than was manufactured prior to 1990. And we also know that we can spec a truck that will be roughly the same size as what we have now, so wherever we can put our current aerial, we would be able to put that truck. It would not be restricted any further than what we have now. No matter what aerial ladder we buy, it won't fit in all neighborhoods in Cape Elizabeth, because several of the private areas just will not allow the size of a truck. Some of them we even have trouble getting the engines in. So we know that if we can specify a truck that will meet the needs of the community, we can put it anywhere we want, and we know that it will last from 25 to 30 years. We felt it was a more cost-effective way to go at this point. Unfortunately, we're coming before you at a time that is not the best economic-wise, and we realize we're asking for the expenditure of a large amount of money, but we believe in the long run this is the best way to go. We also, in the note I sent to the council, we recommended that we transfer all existing equipment from our current ladder, which most of it is in fine operating condition, to the new truck, which would save money, as normal practice is to replace and upgrade when you purchase a new truck. But we would move the equipment such as the air packs, smoke ejectors, generators, the high cost items, transfer those to the new truck, which would result in cost savings, radios, and replace those on an as needed basis. This report is the recommendation of the ladder truck committee. It was is a unanimous recommendation of both the ladder truck committee and the board of engineers of the department. That concludes my part of the presentation. I don't know if you want to entertain questions at this point or.
Thank you very much, Deputy Chief Gleason. The councilors did have an opportunity this evening to examine the chassis and the aerial. And it's obviously not good, and it's obviously not a situation where we have that piece of apparatus for our use at the present time. So clearly we have a problem on our hands, and an expensive one at that. Are there councilors who wish to clarify any of the remarks that either Mr. Murray or Mr. Gleason have made? Councilor Cogsell.
Yes. Deputy Chief Gleason, I believe when we were examining the truck this evening, you told us the number of times it is called out yearly and for what uses.
Yes, we used it. It responded to box alarms 69 times in the calendar year of 1991, and it was used on service runs an additional number, but for fire emergencies it was 69 times we responded it.
And for anything that's associated with schools, it automatically goes out?
It responds automatically on all box alarms, which would be for the schools, any private dwelling, automatic fire alarm or a call that their house is a fire, chimney fire, we responded automatically.
Councilor McLaughlin.
If we have this truck now that's been partially or totally condemned, the existing truck, is it just going to sit there?
We are running it still
at
this point in time.
What kind of use can we get out of it, if any, right now?
Right now, we run it as an equipment truck. It has the full complement of ground ladders, which is still serviceable, the air packs, the salvage covers, all the miscellaneous hand tools, and the lights.
Okay. What would be the fate of that truck?
That would be up in the air. We would dispose of it.
Do we get any? Can we sell it to somebody?
I would hope so. But for how much, I'm not sure.
Yeah. We'll get scrap value, hopefully. Maybe more. Yeah. It's a really good truck.
The chassis and the engine are only 10 years old, and they've certainly not been abused anymore. That part of the truck's in fine shape. It's the aerial ladder that doesn't work.
Okay, so there is potential that we can
see some
profit.
It would have some use to someone. How much they'd be willing to pay for that use, I'm not sure yet.
Okay. My understanding is what you're looking at is a midship model, again, for the aerial truck,
yes,
rather than the rear-mounted.
Is it our feeling that a midship mount for our town and for our department is a better piece of equipment than what most departments buy, which is a rear-mount aerial, which is a bigger truck than what we need. We would like to keep the truck as small as possible so that we can get it in the same areas that we can get our current one in.
I have told you privately, I need to say it publicly, how delighted I am that we're not talking about a truck that's going to immediately necessitate reconstruction of the building. That was one of my major concerns when this was first being discussed. We need a ladder truck, and it's got to be 12 feet high, so we can't get it in the building, and therefore we need a new building. I'm like, whoa, wait a minute. I'm delighted with this kind of suggestion as opposed to that, and I do believe that what you're looking at is a good fit with the needs of the community and the needs of the firefighters who we have out there. I think you folks have done a very good job in doing your research. I hope Gilly's legs are feeling okay and his dialing fingers are still all right. And I think you've done a very good written presentation for us. I will say I was one of at least two counselors here who previously was saying, especially when you were saying we need a bigger building, let's talk about mutual aid. I did not at that time have as clear an understanding of mutual aid as I do now. You have done your work well in educating me about mutual aid. You've done a good job with that. I think you've done some fine work, and I am supportive of the new truck.
Thank you.
Are there any, this isn't a public hearing, but I'm delighted to take any particular questions or comments from anyone in the audience, firefighters included. Please come on right down.
Good Rick Hall, Reef Road, Cape Elizabeth.
I have just one question for the chief. I wonder if anybody looked into government surplus.
Yeah.
If you have. Yeah. Thank you. That's the question.
And we're still looking into it.
Any other questions from the public? Please come on right down. Sure, sure, please. Just identify yourself.
Sandy Ferris, and I live at 21 Cottage Lane. And I've had personal experience with the Cape Elizabeth Fire Department. We live in the Cape Cottage Casino. And I cannot speak more highly of the young men out there that risk their lives every day. And my home would not be standing today if it were not for their diligent training and concern for the community. And if you have ever had a loss, as we had, you know, $300,000, it's still standing. But I just couldn't say enough for the community to put a little bit of extra support there, because our lives are on the line. Their lives are on the line. How many times a day, a week, through the year? And they are very conscientious and work very, very hard. And I'm just here to say, I really appreciate all that you guys do for us that go unmentioned. You're really our heroes, and I want to thank you for that.
Thank you.
And I support you in whatever.
Thank you very much.
I'm Chuck Wilson, live on Mitchell Road, and I knew that Irv would be disappointed if I didn't come up and say something tonight. For those of you who may not know, I served as fire chief for 3 years and deputy chief for 7, and I wholeheartedly endorse the proposal that they've put forward. I think they've done their homework. I think they've looked at the options, and I think that's what's important. The first reaction, I think, was when the word was out that it was sick, was, oh, let's get a new one. It's a big pen, throw it away and get a new one. But I think the people have done their study. They have identified the need. And I think the most important thing that we need to recognize is that back in 1975, we recognized that as the town grew, we had a need for an aerial ladder. Prior to that, we had what we referred to as a lumber truck. It just carried ground ladders. And if you ever try to put up a 55-foot ground ladder in the middle of a snowstorm, you'll understand why they need the aerial ladder. But we made the decision back then, and Councilor Jordan and myself were directly involved when we made the decision to rebuild that truck and try to get another 10 to 15 years for the town without spending, at that point, would have been $250,000. So I think we've got our investment in that truck if you figure that we've spent about $90,000 in total since 1975 for that vehicle, so that we've tried to make a conscious decision to get the value for the town. Most importantly, though, I think, is I want to reemphasize the mutual aid piece. It's our responsibility as a town to provide the basic services that are necessary. You cannot rely on other communities to do it except in dire emergencies or major conflagrations. An example would be the Cottage Farms school fire, where we had 3 aerials there. One obviously wasn't enough. That's true mutual aid. The most important thing about it, though, is that it provides a safety platform for these people to work on. And that's, I think, what our real objective here is. After having spent 25 years myself in the fire service, we need to give them the tools that will allow them to do the job that a lot of people don't want to do safely. And that's really my only comments. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Wilson. If and when this new apparatus comes into town, I certainly hope, Chief, that there can be a transfer of the very shiny brass plaque to the next apparatus.
That was not my motivation.
Not at all. We're very proud of all of you. Other comments? Comments again from the council, then I'll turn my eyes back to the bench. Councilor Jordan, please.
I just have a couple of comments. I would like to ask one question before I continue with my comments. And if the ladder truck made 59 runs, how many times was the ladder raised?
I'd have to check into that.
thought you would have done that before you come tonight. You knew I was going to ask the question.
Wait, it was 59 or 69?
69.
69 times it went out officially. Okay.
I just want to say that I believe the town of Cape Elizabeth needs another ladder truck. I've been supportive of a ladder truck. I've been involved with the fire department for, I won't say 40 years, but it's 35 plus. And I know what they go through and all this and that, and I don't think there's anybody in this room or anybody in this council that doesn't want to have the safety equipment for anybody that's fighting a fire or going into a building. But I do feel that I got to sit here and think of the taxpayers of the town of Cape Elizabeth and feel that I can't vote right tonight that we're going right out and buy a ladder truck, because I feel it should be go into the budget process for the 1993 budget to see just when and how that we can do it, whether through a bond issue or something else or some way or another. And I won't be ashamed to make a motion for that effect.
I'll second that.
Okay, we do have the motion that would be the town council this evening would acknowledge the receipt of the report from the chief, and we would defer a decision on the actual expenditure until the fiscal year 1993 budget process takes place. Is that accurate enough? Okay, Councillor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm going to wholeheartedly support this motion. I do want to say that the projected cost we're looking at is $325,000 to $350,000, is my understanding. As Deputy Chief Gleason mentioned, there is equipment on the existing truck that can be transferred to a new truck, and that gives us a nice cost savings right there. My understanding is that, looking at the time frame for this, we would be looking at 2 to 3 months to get this, 2 to 3 to 4 months, I'm having different numbers all of a sudden, to get the specifications and bid process undertaken, and then probably up to 8 months for delivery of the truck once that's happening. That's getting close to 1 year. It may be possible that this is not funded in the FY93 budget, but is put off to some extent to the FY94 budget. So for the councilors considering their vote on this, I'm not sure that the entire cost would have to be borne in the upcoming budget that we're going to be discussing this spring. I think that's the best case scenario is, considering that it doesn't all have to be funded for the next fiscal year.
Thank you. Thank you for the clarification. Councillor Cogsell.
And I think if you're talking about 1 year from the time of setting things out to bid with the specs and having delivery, and then we're talking about our budget having to be completed by May, we're talking about a long time frame being without any kind of a truck. Is it possible to start the bid process without having to actually allocate the money to shorten that time frame?
It's possible. I assume that question was to me.
Yes.
Yeah.
I was looking that way.
Yeah, it's possible, but I don't think it's fair to the vendors or to anyone to just send out conceptual specs. We don't know if we're going to fund this or not. I think certainly the department could begin to prepare specs, but before we had vendors out submitting bids, I think it's morally correct to have made a commitment of a project, recognizing that if the bids come in above the estimates, that's another thing, but usually we don't put the private sector through all sorts of bidding rigmarole unless we really intend to do something.
Councillor McLaughlin.
I share that concern with you, Councillor Cogshaw. I did ask a couple of members of the fire department about that. I said, so what do we do now? We've got this truck, it's operating as an equipment truck. What do we do when we need an aerial truck? I think this is where we see the true spirit of mutual aid from our neighboring communities, that they have indicated and have demonstrated in the past couple of months their willingness to send ladder trucks to our community when they're needed, and as far as I know, they're willing to do that for the duration until we get a new ladder truck, with the understanding that that's what's going to be happening, and they're nodding their heads up and down. But yeah, I think it's a very valid concern. I certainly share it.
Councilor Jordan.
Why I made the motion that way is I feel by the when we're into our budget process, there's a possibility that we could fund half of this truck, cost of this truck, in 92 and maybe half, I mean in 93 and half in 94. But at that time, we would be making equipment so they could go out and get their bids and get the truck on its way of being built. And our mutual aid agreement with the surrounding communities, as everyone said, is very good. And I think we've gone their way many times, and we've rented them other equipment. So I think they're all, always have been, and will continue to support us until we get do something.
Further comments? All those in favor, signify with your right hand, please. We have a 7-0 vote. Thank you very much. I will take a 5-minute break at this particular point, and we'll regroup at about 10:03. Thank you very much.
Those strange
Cove Shopping Center and take any necessary action. Before recognizing Carol Fritz, who is the chair of our recycling committee, I would only like to say publicly that as I continue to watch the statistics week after week on Thursday's Portland Press Herald, it continues to thrill me that CAPE really is taking the lead, certainly in Cumberland County, with regard to recycling. CAPE recycled in excess of 10% of our materials for December 1991. This is the first time any community in Cumberland County in the RWS program has achieved this kind of benchmark, and I think it remains amazing that CAPE Elizabeth, with its population, is still recycling in excess of South Portland, for whom the population is virtually three times as high. We are only really second at this particular point to Portland in this area, and obviously their population is well five or six times in excess of Cape Elizabeth. So I would like to publicly thank Carol and her committee, as well as the citizens of Cape Elizabeth, for the extraordinary effort that we are putting forth with regard to the recycling efforts. And at this time, we would like to recognize Carol and her committee, but her in particular, to address this topic this evening.
Hey, Regional Waste Systems is offering communities additional recycling bins so that Cape Elizabeth is entitled to another bin. And the committee has been looking at various sites in the town, trying to figure out where it would be good to locate it. And we really came to the conclusion that the IGA parking lot in the Pond Cove Shopping Center would be the best place. So we have, we think that it is a visible place where people are already going. We're trying to increase participation, particularly trying to reach some of the 10 or 15% that's estimated that have private haulers pick up their waste and don't regularly make the trip through the transfer station. There's already the Goodwill and Salvation Army collection bins there. We think that there is space for maneuvering and siting the bins. Public Works has said that they can watch the bins, call when it needs to be picked up. And Peter Conforti at the IGA and other leasers at the Pond Cove Shopping Center seem to be supportive, and we've gotten some signatures and letters from them. We also drew up an agreement for between the town and RWS and the owners of the property, and we did get, I think you have a copy of that agreement signed by the Bolus Company that is managing the IGA or the Pond Cove Shopping Center. As I indicated in the memo to you, we did find out after this contract was signed by the Bolus Company that the recycling container weighs about 4.5 tons when it's full and will make dents in the parking lot pavement. And so it really is necessary for a slab to be placed down, a cement slab, in order to keep from damaging that parking lot. And that would cost approximately $1,500 to $1,700. As I said, the Bolus Company did sign this before we knew about the slab. And in talking with them, they are not at this time in a position to come into agreement with the town about the slab, about that kind of permanent arrangement. They are really just managing the property for the court. Until the property is disposed of in some way, and that is very indefinite at this time, when it would be or who the new owner would be. So it's a rather uncomfortable situation, I suppose, for me, because I'm asking for something that's out in the future or indefinite. We do think the site has great potential for increasing recycling. And as was mentioned, we have done a very good job in Cape Elizabeth recycling. We've easily met the 25% goal for 1992 set by the state. We do certainly have to do a lot more, and it will be harder to get the additional amount to meet the 1994 goal of 50%. And that'll have to primarily come out of the residential waste stream through recycling. So it is important to increase. But you do need to remember that every bit that we recycle, it has an avoided amount that we don't have to pay that's taken for regular trash. So I guess what I'm asking the council tonight is whether we should continue to pursue having a recycling bin at the IGA, whether the town would be willing to spend money, the $1,500 to $1,700, to put in a cement slab on that private property when the property ownership is resolved, and if you have any additional concerns about the contract or the agreement that we put together. And particularly, I guess, number six, if you did want to put money into a slab, it seems that the town would want to have a longer-term agreement with being able to site the recycling bin on the piece of property.
Thank you very much, Carol. Could I address the issue of the
Please.
Slab for a moment?
Sure, sure.
Yeah. Bob Malley and I had a discussion about the slab, I think Carol was involved in it as well, of the possibility, you know, we wouldn't be in the market of putting in a slab during the winter months anyway. What we're looking is, you know, as we get into the hot season, and that, you know, if there is interest in getting this started, you know, the plan was to put it there without the slab, and, you know, if there was a little bit of damage, you know, we're in the business of repairing a little bit of damage, and, you know, eventually if there was a different owner and there was a problem, we do have other municipal property in the area that it could be relocated, but there has been some demand for this. I don't think it was in any of the information you were given, but you know, I think we all see recycling now as a real cost savings in terms of avoided cost, and it's something you need to invest a little bit in order to have that avoided cost, because as Chairman Krellman mentioned, because of the fact that we have recycled so well, we have the second highest avoided cost of any community out of all the regional waste communities. Right now, from the numbers Carol last showed me, I think the avoided cost is around $16,000. And you know, while you know that needs to be made up somewhere else, the fact that we are at the forefront
of avoiding costs means that those who aren't doing so well will be the ones picking it up, not us. So, you know, I would hope that you know, we could move forward and that this could be placed on site, you know, with the current agreement that's here, and that, you know, as the warmer months come up, if the property is not resolved, you know, then perhaps we look at moving it at another site in the immediate area and putting the concrete pad under it. We do have a small amount left in the refuse disposal equipment fund, but it, you know, it's a very small amount, but it would be enough to do this. So I you know, would strongly encourage the council to continue to move forward on recycling. It's one of the few hopeful signs as we look at all the sad things going on that, you know, people, one, people are responding to, but number two, it's something that, we can save money on, and number three, it's appropriate environmental. Thank you.
May I just respond to that as far as putting the recycling bin temporarily or on site before the slab is put in? I spoke with the Bolus company about that, and they did not feel that they had the ability within their responsibilities that the court has given them that they would be able to approve that. That they would have to go back to the court in order to broaden or their ability to agree with the town. And we would then have to stand for legal costs in doing that, which would probably be $250 to $300.
Even though they've already signed this?
I don't know all the...
I don't know. I had a long talk today with the property manager for the Bolus company, not about this, but about another topic, and they do have some a lot of people they need to touch base with. We were trying to resolve another issue over there.
Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Carol, how soon do we have to accept the second bin from RWS? Is there a time frame within which we have to take some action on this?
No, there isn't. I mean, they are ready to drop it tomorrow, probably, should we decide, but that's been, you know, I know of no limitation.
Okay, I hadn't heard of any. I just wanted to verify that. Is this the same bin configuration as the existing bin at the transfer station?
It probably would not. In talking with this with Peter Conforti at the IGA, he felt that it was really necessary for the, you know, you see the long strip on the crude map that I gave you. And that's not the same as at the transfer station. They would sit side by side at the transfer station, but they'd have to be long, and because of the traffic pattern through the shopping center.
So this would be twice as long as what
it'd be twice as long but half as wide
as what we right now have at the transfer station.
Right.
Okay. Is there still, at one point it seemed to me that there was a problem with the bin at the transfer station with the plastic section filling up more rapidly than the others. Is that still the situation?
It still does. We keep trying to tell people that they need to crush the plastic, mm-hmm. because it does fill up. It's so light. And now that we're starting to have to pay to haul away each one of the containers, it really is more important that people crush the plastic.
So is the payment we make based on if they haul the plastic container? Do they haul it? Plastic container or
the whole thing.
So do we wait until every bay is filled?
You wait until the first one is full, and then but we also are on a regular schedule at the transfer station so that it's three times a week.
Is there any way to have two of the bins for plastic?
That's
and maybe not take newspapers at this one or something like that. My concern is with the plastic one filling up so fast that we're having to haul more than we might otherwise, more frequently than we might have to haul otherwise.
I think another town or two are exploring that as a possible second use for a second recycling bin. Mm-hmm. We felt that it would be rather confusing for people to always have it changing, never being, you know, the plastic would be in a different place every time, and you'd have to hunt around for it, and we might likely get more contamination and frustration with the program. So we really felt it wasn't an advantage to have a second bin at the transfer station.
Okay, I'm saying, what if the bin, if we were to get a bin in the IGA parking area, a bin, if two of the compartments there were for plastic, they started out that way, and you always had two for plastic, and you know, maybe, as I said, didn't have a newspaper bin there.
Yeah, but then you'd have one thing, somebody go up and to recycle four things, and you couldn't recycle four.
Well, some people aren't recycling newspaper anyway. Okay, just, I am concerned about the plastic bay filling up before the others fill up. I know you've mentioned that it costs us now to have this hauled. Do you know how much can you tell me how much it costs every time it's hauled?
It'll be $22.
Okay.
Mr. Manager, I think Michael had a clarification just a moment ago.
No, I did, but I'll go back to it later.
Okay.
Okay. Has anything been said by Pond Cove Mill Works about having this place very close to their property? Have they expressed any concern about having it next to their property?
We have not approached them.
Okay. One concern I have is that if it is going to be in the IGA lot, that it does get hauled as soon as it needs to be. I don't, you know, I would hate, and I know the owners, they must have brought this up, I would hate to see trash accumulate there and hate to see people using it as a dumping place for other non-recyclable materials. Another concern I have is that it would be, the town is paying $22 a time to have it hauled. The IGA parking lot gets very busy in the summertime with a lot of non-Cape Elizabeth residents in that parking lot. The advantage is that apparently we would get credit for anything they recycled. The disadvantage is we're paying to haul materials that people from other towns deposit. I would hope that would even out and would counteract each other.
Now, the other communities are attempting to locate recycling bins as well. I mean, there's one up just near Cape Elizabeth on Shore Road or in Cottage
Public Works in South Portland.
Right.
On O'Neill Street.
So those people might find it more convenient to go there. But, you know, Scarborough is attempting to find sites as mm-hmm. well.
Okay, thank you.
Other questions?
Based on what Mrs. Fritz said, you know, I really would like to see this move forward, but, you know, I would hope that, you know, the council could, you know, approve this with the understanding that, number one, we get a new signature, so there's no doubt from a representative of the shopping center. Number two, that, you know, I think we can approach, it's the bankruptcy court, approach the bankruptcy court working with the Bolases on this without having to get an attorney. You know, I think, you know, you live in a society, you don't need to get an attorney every time to do whatever you need to do. You know, spoke of earlier, we had a problem with the septic, with the sewer system over there. And, you know, they had trouble getting permissions to do certain things, but I made it very clear to them today, after Ernie had already made it clear to them that they didn't have too much time to resolve it. And when they had a tight deadline, they got the permissions and they resolved it. But, you know, I would hope that, we could work these things out, and that there'd be the impetus to get moving on this. That recycling does pay, and we do need to find savings. And, you know, if we end up taking a little bit of trash from someone else, you know, Cape people take an awful lot of trash elsewhere, it's just the way the system works.
I mean, if I can just finish a bit, it appears that what I have in front of me is missing at least one page of the license agreement.
There are three pages?
I only have two. I'm missing, yeah, I've got numbers 5, 6, and 7 on my last, item numbers 5, 6, and 7 on my last page. I don't have item numbers 1 through 4, however. So I would like to see that sometime.
Nor do I.
This was an agreement prepared by Regional Waste Systems. And only when we got it, it had a second page.
Okay, yeah.
Councilor Pearson.
Yes, Chairman Kremer. I just have one thought here, and I don't even know what the feasibility is, and I'll address to Carol, but also ask the town manager or anyone else that might know the lay of the land. Could a potential site be, and maybe Bulos might be a little more receptive if we said, how about if we take apart one part of the chain link fence between the school parking lot and locate the bins on the school parking lot? No?
Bulos might be receptive, but you know, we're still analyzing. We already downsized that parking lot already this year, and this bin would, you know, take that many more spaces, and I'd be a little reluctant to further downsize that the student parking lot after just having done it this past year.
Just a thought.
Yeah, I had given the same thought.
Park them down below.
Well, easier said than done.
Councilor Chappell.
I think this is a great idea, and I move that we let the committee go ahead with their proposed plans, with the safeguards that the town manager has given us, the things that he thinks are required to make it, and let them go ahead.
Second. Councilor Jordan.
I would just like to say that I think that is a proper place for it, because it gives it access on Sunday where our other facility is closed on Sunday. And a lot of people do this, you know, go to the store there on Sunday, and it would be very convenient for them. And I would hope, and I agree that we need the cement pad, and I just hope that you can work out something with them. I don't know what you have in mind, or whether you have in mind a raised pad, or you was going to dig out a certain area and end up with the same ground level that you have now with the pavement. So if anything happened in the future, it went somewhere else, or something else happened, that there would be no raised area there. It would be all on the same level of the parking lot. And I didn't understand whether that was your intention or not.
For the reason of loading and unloading the truck off that, it makes, you know, just makes a whole lot of sense to keep it the same level. You don't want people tripping, you know, particularly as the things shift back and forth, too.
But
you
as
want
I,
to have it even to the ground.
Yeah, mm-hmm. But as I look at this diagram, they're going to back up back-to-back and not on the side. Is that correct?
Yeah, but even then, you don't want a step where someone approaches the thing, they could trip over it as they, you know, because it'd be, you know, right at the front of it.
I haven't seen my stool for the shot people yet, and it's, I think it's still a dangerous one.
Was a stool there?
There's going to be a lower door.
Oh. And another thing, I think they both should be alike, so it don't confuse people. That you just put this in one, and you got to take the other stuff to the other one. I think you've got to have them both similar, so they'll take the material the same.
We have a motion and a second. Further discussion? All those in favor? We have 7 votes. Thank you very much. 7-0. Item number 111 this evening is to consider a request for a quit claim deed for lots U14-36, 36E, and 36H off Hannaford Cove Road, and take any necessary action. I will defer to our town clerk, Ms. Pizzo, at this particular time, noting that Mr. Egan is also in the audience to field any particular questions.
Thank you very much. This is the first of two separate quitclaim deeds that you're asked to approve this evening. In your packet, you do have the information. When the packet was sent out, there were two specific questions that have been answered by Timothy Norton, the attorney. First of all, we wanted to know what the status was with the bankruptcy court. The bankruptcy court has given permission for these three lots to be sold. The second question was who the quitclaim deed would be signed to, and it was settled that the current record owners, we would sign the quitclaim deeds back to them, who are the Shelleys. I do have also in my possession a check for $1,047.62. It represents all past due taxes plus the first half of the 1992 taxes that would make these taxes on all three lots paid through December 31st, 1991. With that, Mr. Egan is here if you folks have any questions, and I would encourage you to authorize the town manager to sign this quitclaim deed.
Thank you very much, Ms. Pizzo. Are there particular questions for Mr. Egan this evening? Seeing none, that I would entertain a motion. Councilor McLaughlin.
Before I do that, I have a generic question, I guess, about quitclaim deeds. Is there any legal cost to the town in developing or executing these quitclaim deeds?
There's a release fee, you know, if we file it at the registry. You know, in this case, it would probably be filed, though, by the property owner. You know, beyond that, during the whole lien process, we collect fees as we move along for notices and that. But there isn't a specific fee when it comes to the foreclosure. None is allowed by the state law.
Okay. We seem to be seeing more and more of these. I was wondering how it was impacting our legal situation.
On that point, I think this one, there were some legal issues, but we didn't bother to consult with the town attorney on it. There was one last month that we did because we were really unclear about the propriety of quit claiming it to the person that was indicated. Mm-hmm.
Okay. In that case, I would move that we authorize the town manager to sign the quit claim deed before us in item 111.
Second the motion.
Any further discussion? All those in favor? Vote is 7-0. Thank you very much. Item number 112 is to, again, consider a request for a quit claim deed for lot U22-66 on Rand Road and take any necessary action. I will defer again to the town clerk, Ms. Pizzo.
Thank you. On December 9th of last year, 91, the town foreclosed on a sewer lien that had matured that was filed on June 8th, 1990. The current record owner does wish to have the title to the property revert back to his name. I do have in my possession a cashier's check in the amount of $7,434.77. This does represent all past and current sewer charges due to the town, real estate taxes through the 1992 fiscal year, which would pay the taxes through June 30th, 1992, and we have also collected the charges to file this quitclaim with the registry. I would encourage you to authorize the manager to sign this quitclaim.
So moved.
Second.
Any further discussion? All those in favor? Thank you very much. Again, 7-0. Okay, item number 113 this evening is to consider a recommendation regarding holding public hearings for liquor license renewals and take any necessary action. I will defer to Mr. McGovern.
I'm going to take the very unusual step for me of reading a memo. I usually don't, but I think for the benefit of the public on this particular issue. During this difficult economic period, we are constantly looking for ways to save citizens, local businesses, and the town money. One area that has been identified is the procedure for liquor license renewals. State statutes were changed several years ago whereby a public hearing was optional under the state statute. What the law does read, though, is if a hearing is held, notice must be given in a paper of general circulation in the area, in our case the Portland newspaper, for at least 6 consecutive days. The newspaper recognizes that legal ads is something that has to be put in, and they have gone up precipitously in the cost per line. As a result, keeping these things as short as possible, the cost of the legal ad alone is now just under $200, which is borne by the applicant. We noted that it's been at least 20 years since any citizen has objected to the renewal of a liquor license. If someone did wish to object, they could object directly to the Bureau of Alcoholic Beverages in Augusta. And also, if the town clerk or any town councilman became aware of any controversy, a public hearing can always be held. Notices do go to the liquor applicant saying that their licenses are expiring 90 days prior to the actual license expiration. What is proposed is that a new policy be established whereby that the clerk could grant liquor license renewals after requiring first that the applications would have to be in 60 days prior to license expiration, which is an improvement over what we've had because, as you know, we've had some problems with them. and that the clerk also shall give notice to the town council and to the chief of police 45 days prior to all expirations. And then either the clerk, the chief of police, or any council member could request a public hearing to be held. And for those that, you know, no one has ever heard of any problem or have any concern, the applicant could save $200. And, you know, I think this is a worthwhile thing to do, particularly considering that no one has voiced a concern at any time in the last 20 years. Presently, we do have three particular businesses or whatever that are affected by this. There would be the Good Table Restaurant, the Inn by the Sea, and the Paputa Club. And again, you know, if anyone did have any concern with any of those, there still could be a public hearing, but this does give the option of saving the private sector and the nonprofit community, if that's what Paputic is, about $200 a year.
Councilor Amaral.
Rather than having to have a public hearing, couldn't the liquor license renewals just be scheduled as a regular agenda item? And no one would have to pay for the announcements in the paper, et cetera. But yet the council would still have an opportunity, seeing we only have three that we give out each year, that we renew each year, we'd still have the opportunity to review each of the applications.
Yeah, we looked at that, and you know, if you are going to take action on it, you do need to hold a public hearing, and you do need to advertise it for 6 days. When Debbie and I first started looking at this, we thought maybe there was something in there that we could get around the 6-day advertising requirement, that maybe we, you know, we could get it so it's 1 day. Unfortunately, the state statute does not allow us that option.
The state statute says that the clerk can do it automatically and the town council cannot without holding a public hearing. That's what the state statute says?
Yeah.
I'd like to see it. That sounds ridiculous. It
not everything in the state statute is necessarily sensible.
True. Can be changed, too.
It can be changed, but
Mr. Chairman, I would just like to say, and I was thinking on the same lines as Councilor Amaral, that maybe this could be a agenda item and then you wouldn't get into the cost. I'm believing saving the cost, but it's unbelievable to me that there can't be some kind of a notice put up somehow, some way, like an agenda notice that is public. If anybody hears about it, can come in and get it. I'm not doubting the authority or the word of the town clerk or what have you, but some people, I think, feel that they like to talk to their representative within the town if they have a problem with it, rather than go to the town office. So, but you say it's not legal to have an item agenda. I'll take your word for it, and I can't see why we can't have an item agenda and then vote to allow the manager or the clerk to sign the agreement the same way as we do with what am I trying to think on the real estate quick claim deeds.
You could do that. It's, you know, unless someone challenged the fact that it wasn't advertised, you know, in accordance with the state statute, that's the, you know, and then they'd just appeal it to the liquor commission and they'd do whatever they please anyway.
I don't know, if I say something, somebody will figure I'm doubting the word of the manager and the clerk, but I would like to see this explored and understand why we can't do it the other way. I would like to see a memo to that effect.
Now, what I tried to do, Bill, was to figure out a way with the deadlines that if it could be timed such that you could have one meeting and then decide whether or not you want to call a public hearing. You know, you'd have it as an agenda item and then, yes, we want a public hearing, no, we don't. And what my calculation showed at the time when I looked at it, it would work most months, but it, depending on when they filed their application and everything else, it might not work with some, particularly if they don't meet the council deadline for getting it on. And there might not be enough time after that council meeting to still hold the public hearing and do all that prior to their expiration. It just wasn't working.
Okay, I spoke my piece.
Well, I think the possibilities are several. Does anyone want to move the motion, make a motion at this point?
I used to make a motion.
All right, fine.
Let me look at my memo so maybe I get halfway straight or something. I'll make a motion that we do not recommend this policy, and that is we would look at it further so the council could have some input into the licensing.
So is this a tabling motion, essentially, then to refer it back to the town manager for more options? I'm not exactly clear of the intent. It just kills it.
My intent was to kill it.
Leave it the way it is.
Yeah, my intent was to kill it and leave it the way it is, and they could look at it and come back with another recommendation at a later date.
All right. I think, is that clear to everyone? Okay. There is a motion and a second. Is there any discussion at this point? Councilor McLaughlin.
I'm trying to decide if I have a problem with the recommendation from the manager or not. It seems to me that if there is concern, people in this town are pretty good about contacting their counselors. And the recommendation includes a provision that if a counselor wanted to have a public hearing, that would be done. That gives the citizens their voice for putting it to public hearing. And I think that sounds adequate, that we don't need a public hearing in all cases. And if there's a problem, we generally get it through the grapevine anyway, either through citizens or through town staff. So I think this makes sense the way it's recommended.
Any other input? Yes, Councilor Pearson.
Chairman Creelman, the only problem with any of this is that the public doesn't know when licenses come up for renewal. The only way I think that you can get around that is, I don't know what an ad in the Courier cost versus an ad in the Portland Press, but can you put that the license for such and such a establishment is coming up for renewal?
You could put it in the Courier.
And
however, that does not meet
it.
The state statute standard of, if it's in a weekly newspaper, it's got to be in for at least 2 weeks under the state law. Otherwise, it has to be a newspaper of general circulation,
no,
which the Courier is not.
What I'm suggesting
in a daily paper for
is,
6 days.
Is can this be brought up 60 days before, when the renewal is taken out, the application, so that if there is any community input, that it can be made before a general public hearing has to be made notice of. In other words, if it's 60 days before the license is to expire, that gives you 2 months. If in that time you can easily put it in the next issue of the Courier, and that still buys you a month if there's that much problems or concerns, because this is being exclusionary and saying that citizens aren't aware that something's coming up, so how are they going to say anything on it anyways? And how are we going to find out if there's a doubt? Do they arbitrarily any time of the year come up and say, we've got some concerns about a liquor license?
Yeah. I'm not going to be
I don't know if that's...
Councilor Amaral.
Beyond that, I think it wouldn't be more than a year or so before this council changed over that future councils wouldn't even know that there was this possibility of bringing it before the council. I think it would become something that the whole community would become unaware of very quickly.
No, because every time one was sent out, we would send it to the council with it. You have to please notify us by X date, you know, that you want this on the agenda, because, you know, otherwise, oh, I've been meaning to call you, you know, not the councils would do that, but it's getting late. I was just trying to find a way to save money. Perhaps the answer to this is to go to the legislature and see if they can make 6 days one day, you know, because that's the root of the problem, is that the newspaper has taken this law, that they, you know, they're using it as a cash cow, and you know, perhaps we can get the legislature, because if people read legal ads, they read them every day, they don't read them every, you know, 6 days or whatever. It's a stupid law.
That's one avenue, and I think we ought to pursue that. But another might be taking another look at the statute the way it's written to see if we can't find a way to do what we want to do without having this cost to the applicant.
Okay.
I thought Councilor Cox was going to have a hand up. I thought you had a, I just got one little thought here. That this, does a 60-day deal bother here is for the applicant to get word in? Is that really what the problem is? That isn't the problem, because we're trying to save them a couple hundred bucks, so I think we could get all the cooperation in the world there from the applicant, but that isn't the problem. It's a notice problem.
The problem's the 200 bucks, and it's, you have to have the 60 days because of, in order, if someone does want to have the hearing, to make sure there's plenty of public notice and all that.
Councilor Coxall.
Have the applicants complained about the fee, the $200 advertising fee?
In the past, we have had some concern expressed. In particular, I'm thinking of one that was a prior owner of where the Good Table is now. As a matter of fact, that year, that applicant did not go for a liquor license because of that. They were on their way out anyway. But.
Okay. I just wanted to know if we were just acting out of, if there really had been a reason for your taking this issue, there had been a complaint.
It had been voiced. We were just trying to be charitable, and we're always looking for ways to save people money.
Okay. I'd like to hear
that. We're going to run out of time.
There is a motion and a second. Is there further discussion on the motion? All those in favor, please raise your right hand. One, two, three, four, five. And all those who are not in favor, two. The motion does carry. We will revert back to the exact way we have always done it. Thank you very much. 5-2 vote. Item number 114 this evening is to consider acknowledging receipt of the 5-year budget impact schedule and take any necessary action. I will defer to the town manager.
At your workshop last Thursday night, you reviewed the 5-year budget impact statement. I would like to make extensive comments this evening, but due to the lateness of the hour, I won't. But I would urge you to acknowledge receipt of it.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? Unanimous vote, 7-0.
Copies are available to the public if anyone would like to come in and get them.
Item number 115, maybe good news, to consider the mid-year budget status report and take any necessary action. Again, the town manager will take this item.
At your last council meeting, I promised that at the end of the year, I would relook at all revenues and expenditures and try to project them forward to the end of the fiscal year. Subsequently did that. The revenue sharing cut wasn't quite as great as it could have been, but you know, we still don't know what's going to happen for next year's budget. But anyway, the amount that was reduced in last year's budget was just over $200,000. The actual projected net deficit revived after looking at everything again was $108,370, leaving a net positive position of $91,630. First of all, I'd like to apologize. Apparently, this wasn't in the packet and intended to. But what I'd like to recommend is that we retain the projected $91,630 to provide for the following contingencies. One, an increase in uncollected taxes. Some of you may have seen the early news on Channel 13 tonight and the problems another community is having because of that particular issue. An allowance for abatements. Again, pursuant to a recommendation in the management letter. A winter more severe than budgeted. Keep our fingers crossed every day. That doesn't happen. Four, a balance of funds after the above items could be used to avoid personnel reductions in next year's budget. And then it isn't listed five, but obviously we have the fire truck issue. So I would recommend that rather than reinstate some of the funds that were cut, that you hold these funds for these contingencies.
Sounds good.
Do I have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion on these items? All those in favor? 7-0 vote. Thank you very much. Item number 116 is to consider a proposed general assistance ordinance and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern.
The state in late December revised the general assistance statute for the state. The Maine Municipal Association, as one of their services, has provided us a draft general assistance ordinance. A public hearing does need to be held on this, and I would recommend that you schedule a public hearing for your meeting on the second Monday in February, 7:30 p.m.
February the 10th.
February. Yeah, February. Isn't it the 10th?
Yes.
The 10th.
I'll be here.
So moved.
So moved.
Second.
Second. Any discussion? All those in favor? Thank you very much. We will have at least one public hearing in our February meeting. Wouldn't be a town council meeting without a public hearing. Item 117. I guess, do we have to formally...
this was an addendum. Take an item out of order, number 117.
I second.
Okay, all those... any discussion? All those in favor? Thank you very much, 7-0. Item number 117 is to consider the following appointments for 1992 and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern.
I would recommend the following appointments for 1992. Assessor, Code Enforcement Administrator, Gerald E. Daigle. Building Inspector, Code Enforcement Officer, Ernest W. McVane. Local Plumbing Inspector, Ernest W. McVane and Gerald E. Daigle. And Health Inspector, or Deputy Health Inspector, should be Ernest W. McVane Jr. and Gerald E. Daigle.
Mr. Chairman, I move we accept the recommendations for these appointments.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Is there any discussion other than to thank all of these individuals for the very good work that they do? All those in favor? Again, a unanimous vote, 7-0. Okay, at this point, we will ask for citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Is there... please come right down to the podium and state your name and your concern.
My name is Jerry Jackson, 25 Thrasher Road. And basically, my only concern is during the November meeting, we listened to the meeting at home and remember Mr. McGovern stating that he was going to have some figures on the community center. I'm curious as to whether or not those figures have been brought forward to the council.
The council did receive a report on that. I don't have it with me tonight, but I'd be happy to make it available to you.
Was that available last month, or is that available now? Or
it's available now. I don't...
we had it for last month's meeting.
Was it before the meeting? Mm-hmm. Yeah.
My question, I guess, is how much that the figures ended up over budget from the original figures?
Because they are slightly over budget, and I don't remember off the top of my head. I believe it was... there are several different ways that one could look at the numbers. The way the report presents it, I think it's 8,000 to 9,000, but the report really lays it out as to what the original plan was and what it ended up. The entire project was including the purchase of the property, the work that was done to the town hall here, the work that was done inside, and the work that was done outside over there was just over 300,000.
What was the initial plans for the figures, do you remember?
The plan was 190,000 for the purchase of the property, which is what it was, and 110,000 for the interior and exterior improvements. 110 did run over.
What was the run over on the 110? So what was the basic...
I don't remember off the top of my head, but I'd be happy to give you the report and have given it to the courier and the bulletin papers already as well.
Did that figure also include the public works labor that was included in that project?
No, we did not charge the public
works. Do you have any idea what that was?
We generally don't charge all those projects, but they did a considerable amount of work over there, not as much as we anticipated because they got tied up with Hurricane Bob and cleanup. I would guess about $15,000 worth of labor and equipment.
I guess my concern, Mike, and that I've mm-hmm. talked to you about it and several councilors, is that we keep hearing in the town about how we're trying to save money and we're trying to cut budgets and make everything that's needed in the town go, and yet I'm all in favor of having a project such as that for the future, but why would you spend that type of money upgrading the project when we don't have enough money to make the town flow? It just doesn't make sense to a common person. And I'm wondering how anybody that sits up here can justify that.
Mr. Chairman.
Sure.
I think everybody has to realize that we make the best decision that we can at the time when we're making the decision with the economic facts as they are at that time. When we were making these decisions, we're talking about decisions made well over a year ago. These were made in public session. We did not have people in the audience discouraging us from going forward with the project to an extent that we felt we needed to pull in the reins on it. It's very easy to be a Monday morning quarterback right now with the economy. Nobody then was telling us what that the economic situation was going to be what it is today. If we'd had different information then, we may have had a different decision.
That's exactly what you told me in private too, Janet, but
that's good. I'm glad I'm consistent.
I don't think anybody's trying to be a Monday morning quarterback or just come up here talk negatively about the council. I know there's, from being active in a lot of things in this town, that there are a lot of people that sit back and talk and they're going to do this and they're going to do that and they don't do a lot of things. I'm sure, other than being a Little League umpire, there's not a worse job in the town probably than being a town councilor, and I appreciate, you know, the hours that you people put into it. But on the same token, after what's happened in this town in the last few years, I think it's pretty sad what's going on. I think there's a lot of mistrust. It started with the school roof situation, and it's carried over. And I think that's something that you people have to look at.
Yeah, you know, on that particular point, that is in fact why we have some cost overruns on the project. It related to some of the school issues, and you know, we went out and hired a structural engineer, and they found some loading problems from the first floor down to the basement, and you know, as a result, we put in some beams there. We reinforced all the trusses going along. That we spent about $4,000 more than we had planned on, plus the cost of the structural engineer. We also, you know, spent money very well on professional services on that. We did not, you know, do anything without, you know, checking with people that were more expert than us to make sure it was designed right, it was built right. We spent more in that area than we anticipated. We also spent more because as the plans, when we first had the budget proposal, we hadn't gone before the planning board yet and the zoning board. We needed to get permits from them. They required more landscaping and fencing than we anticipated. Then subsequently, when we built the project, we ran into more ledge than anticipated. We also expanded the parking lot over there by about 6 to 8 spaces over, you know, what was originally intended. But you know, overall, even with those things, I'm pleased that you know we were able to bring in the project as close to the budget as we were. But you know, we deliberately, after the school issues, made sure that we didn't have a repetition of it, and ensured that if we were going to do it, we were going to do it right. Nothing, you know, too elaborate, but that we were going to do it right.
I can appreciate that, Mike. And like I said before, my concern isn't to come up here and chastise the council, like I hope the council doesn't sit here and chastise people that are, as I am, uncomfortable, you know, talking to you people about it in a public forum. But obviously, I think the situations, like I said, over the past few years warrant that. And I think you're very fortunate that we don't have a situation here like they have in South Portland. I think you people do a very good job at bringing it forth in a professional manner. But by the same token, there's a lot of people out there that are having tough times and you know, biting their tongues. So I just wish you'd look at that when you appropriate money for different projects. Thank you.
I need to say, Jerry, I really appreciate your being here and talking to us. I expected to see you last month after we talked on the phone.
Three storms.
We need to hear from people who are distressed and disgruntled, and I encourage other people to let us know how they're feeling. You don't have to always do it in public forum. You can do it on the telephone, and you can do it through written correspondence. We're all the phone numbers are in the book.
But as much as it's uncomfortable for me to do it, I think it's almost as uncomfortable for some of the fellow councilors to discuss in a public forum the things that are told to them by private citizens in a small group.
A lot of us do pretty well at that.
Are you looking at me?
Because I think you're a shining example of doing that well.
Oh.
Sometimes I compliment you.
Thank you.
So, yeah, I hope you are setting an example that other people will follow. And I thank you for doing that.
Thank you.
If someone else watching wants that report as well, if they come in, we'll make a copy for them.
Thank you
very
much.
Just a minute, Jerry. Just a minute. We discussed this at the Mariners quite a couple of times, and I understand where you're coming from. And I think I told you at the time, it's one of those deals where we get caught into with the economy, and this is just what Janet has said a minute ago. The economy really caught us into it. And you know, as I told you, and I told the manager, that I think even though we got caught in the way the economy was, I think we was a little elaborate of what we'd done in the back here and the driveway part of it. But it's one of those things that you get into it, do you go ahead and finish it completely instead of trying to do a little bit more later on, or do you finish it? And that was the decision that was made. And I know there's other people out there who are upset about it because somebody calls the council Tajima because we went overboard on it. But I think in the years to come, and if we can get through this time, that you'll appreciate it, what we have done by looking into the future. And coming up and tell me I'm crazy in hell don't bother me a bit.
I don't think I ever told you that.
Go ahead.
We had two other factors, too, that were putting additional pressure on us. Number one, we were had requirements that were set by the planning board to site approval, and there's a certain amount of deadline time to complete that. And number two, money was bonded to be able to finish this project, and it could not be used for anything else if it's bonded for a particular project. So we had those two things as well that made us have to continue. But when we did make the initial decision and the investigation and having what is his inspector's name that we had to and give us a complete evaluation of the house structurally, whether or not it was, pardon?
Brian Rollins.
Right. So it wasn't a hasty decision, and we did have two or three public meetings.
No, I'm not questioning that it was a hasty decision. I'm
but
just saying, you know.
But looking back now.
You add up $100,000 here and $100,000 there, and
it does accumulate. We're looking at maybe $300,000 to $400,000 for a ladder truck.
And $10,000 for a pond tractor.
Yeah, speaking of the pond. I didn't hear, this is the first I've heard about the pond tractor, but I would like to acknowledge that, you know, we were thanking people earlier this evening that with the leadership of Mr. Jackson, but with the help of a few other people as well, they have taken on the lion's share of responsibility, if you pardon the pun, for maintaining the Lions Field Pond this year. They're out there a lot putting a little extra water on top and otherwise maintaining the pond and making sure that the light is working. And I don't know, as we've all been driving by there, you can see all the kids out there. You know, while Public Works goes and we'll do some of the initial work, the fine clearing of it and some of the other work has been done predominantly with Jerry's leadership.
Yeah, that I didn't want you to bring that up, Mike, but it's by far not only me. There's other guys that are out there till 2 in the morning, like John Norton, John Milligan, Kurt Brown. A lot of the college guys this year, and we've got it pretty well contained so that they're not, you know, killing the little old lady skaters with, or the people with babies with hockey pucks, too. And it's, you know, really been a good community thing. And I'd like to see sometime that they'd be able to, you know, do something in the lines of getting a tractor down there, maybe of our own. And a facility like Scarborough has, it would be really, I mean, literally hundreds of people use that on a weekend. It's New Year's Day. There was 300 people down there. It's really good community thing, whereas Little League is just for the boys and Girl Scouts for the girls. That's for everybody. So next year when we have a lot of money, we'll be back.
We're buying lottery tickets.
Say a prayer.
Thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Jackson.
Thanks,
Jerry. Okay, can we suspend the rules to take this last item here?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor? Thank you. We're going beyond 11 o'clock for item number 118, and this is to consider entering into executive session to discuss the advisability of requesting the Cape Elizabeth Police Patrolmen's Association to reopen the current collective bargaining agreement and take any necessary action. I also would add to that to discuss scheduling dates for the town manager's evaluation, as we don't schedule dates over the air in public so that people don't know when we're in the home and out of the home, as well as to discuss some of the budget scheduling times that will be preferable for us or not preferable. So these would be the items that we would be taking up in executive session.
Mr. Chairman, are you, in talking about the budget times, are you considering discussing the location of those meetings as well?
Yes.
I'm thinking that is best done in public session rather than executive session.
That's perfectly fine. If we would like to address that particular issue here, I'd be happy to. I guess I'm assuming, Counselor, that the issue is whether we have the budget deliberations on that the particular Saturday at the town hall or somewhere else.
That's what I was driving at, right. And I think it comes down to, in part, whether or not we want that. This, we're looking at a full Saturday session like we've done in the past, whether or not we want that televised. If we have it out of town hall, it would not be able to be televised. I wanted to get a feel from people whether or not they want it televised.
I would like to see that Saturday one televised, but I would like to see all budget sessions held in the town hall, so if anybody wants to come, they'll realize that at the town hall, we don't have one here at the town hall, and then have one over the library and things like that. My feeling is they all should be here.
Are there other opinions on this issue, Councilor Cogsell?
I have a serious conflict in that I can only make one of those meetings.
Okay.
As they've been proposed.
Why don't we address that in the executive session, since we can rearrange the times.
After the executive session.
After the executive session. I think the real issue right now is, for all practical purposes, having the all-day Saturday session at 1226 Shore Road as an ancillary part of the town hall, or which would not allow that particular session to be televised, versus having the session here in the basement cafeteria where it has been traditionally been held.
You could televise it, but
here.
Not live.
Right, right. It could be televised at 1226 Shore Road. It would not be live. That would be the issue. Any counselors? Councilor Jordan has given his preference for it to be at the town hall. Are there other opinions about where it could be and why?
I think the public is, and I see value in having it televised. I'm not sure it needs to be televised live. Are you talking live shows, Mr. Jordan?
I like live shows. Let them know that I'm alive. I think they should be televised, and I think it should be live television. If you're here all day and the people could see the process going along, how it's moving, they may be interested in a certain segment of it, and then they could come up here and be present. If you go and televise it, I say do it live and do it that way. To televise it and then play it sometime later on, I can't even watch a basketball game that way because I already know who won, and that's the interested part of it. That's my feeling. I don't know.
Okay, I'm not hearing any groundswell that there ought to be a change this year than prior years. So not hearing that, we will conduct our deliberations, and the budget story will be taking place at the town hall, and it will be televised as it's always been televised without needing to vote on it. All right, at this point, I would ask for a motion for adjournment, given that we will not return back to this chamber, but we will have to enter executive session. So we'll need a motion to enter executive session and then a motion to adjourn.
No,
just a motion, excuse me, a motion to enter into executive session at this time, recognizing that the camera people then can leave for the evening.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you very much. A unanimous vote. Thank you very much for tuning in tonight for our council meeting. Good night.